message begins right now. Many souls amongst us are remembering glimpses of past lives in other constellations. First Nation tribes speak of descending from the stars. Our star soul heritage and karma are greatly influencing the course of events here on Earth right now. If we can gain some kind of insight on how, then it can help people rationalize what they're dealing with in day-to-day life, and ease the path through the karmic plane. There can be nothing more impactful than the shattering Sirius B shift of 120 million years ago. Many souls have come here to process the karma of that. Maybe you have some of the Sirius archetype? Here's an outline from direct personal experience to support your shift. It all began on Lyra in my knowing. The humanoid form first appeared in our galaxy in the constellation Lyra, hundreds of millions of years ago. Essentially, we are all just dozens. Population of the cosmos happened from consciousness, the natural law of attraction drawing related souls to favorable conditions for that particular form. Even though we are all related, we will have distinct resonances with particular constellations, due to the fact that souls will have first emerged in a particular location and have soul families there, such as the Pleiades, for example. However, it is often the case that a star soul will have spent past lives in several constellations. Usually, the law of attraction draws to varying experiences so as to be able to learn and empathize with others. The exception here on Earth are those purely human souls who have only recently emerged here. In comparison, these are relatively young souls that are only a few million years old. When contemplating star soul origins, my sense is it's often considered sexy to have emerged from the Pleiades, Arcturus or Andromeda, for example, but not so much from the constellations Sirius and Orion. That's to do with the shattering impact of the opposing consciousness interventions that took place in these star systems, the highly challenging karma of which many are dealing with right here and now. Although it's something many would rather, understandably, sweep under the inconvenient rug, it is important, however, to have an understanding of those archetypes, because in one way or another, they are going to be influencing all of us, if not internally, then in those we encounter in day-to-day life. So what might the Sirius archetype be? The big C, in a word, the greatest challenge a soul will likely face as a result of Sirius influence is control. The Sirian populations became highly advanced technologically, especially in being able to manipulate the surrounding energy field. If you can manipulate the 4D, then you can easily roll manifestation in the 3D. Life here on Earth, to my mind, is heading rapidly in a similar direction to the Sirius legacy. Genetic modification of the human form and sentient life in the food chain, manipulation of the weather and climate, artificial intelligence to support greater technological advancement, transhumanism to enhance and perpetuate the human form, exploitation of varying energy sources including free energy from the field, physical space travel to populate other planets in our solar system, and in spiritual circles, manipulating the law of attraction to, putting it bluntly, manifest what the ego might want. Although to some, such development may sound cool, it does not bode well for life here on 3D Earth. Nothing is free. Nothing we do is without its minor impact. The law of cause and effect dictates that what you do to a living system will touch lives of all sentient beings in it. If you exploit too much energy in a particular way, that can render the whole system unbalanced and unstable. It can lead to disastrous and explosive consequences, as happened on Sirius 120 million years ago. I've shared a perspective in the book Divinicus: Rise of the Divine Human. To my mind, control is the biggest karmic challenge of life on Earth today. Too many are trying to manipulate the flow in some way, be it through advanced technology, or by using distorted spiritual laws to manifest in a slightly more clever way. It is not clever to overexploit and destroy the very environment on which we depend. neither is it hugely evolved. We'll gain far more by working to understand the natural flow and coming into alignment with it. So what are the specific karma challenges many will be dealing with? Four key influences of the Sirian archetype. Essentially, the influences of the Sirian archetype mostly take place within the lower four chakras. Here is a brief outline of some of the main challenges faced. I've put them in descending order to reflect the density in which they each manifest. 4. Forming fixed opinion and judgment. One of the greatest gifts of the Sirian archetype is to be able to discern the movement of group energy within the consensus reality construct that they're incarnated into. Sirian souls tend to be highly empathic, often feeling other people's feelings and knowing their thoughts. Thus, they tend to form fairly accurate impressions of someone's lower behavioral nature, why they make certain choices, for example, if someone is trustworthy, and what might be being concealed subconsciously. When this attribute is properly activated, it means that souls with this archetype will likely be very successful at manifesting resources and outcomes in the physical density. They'll be good leaders and killer. However, it often also leads to judgmentalism and fixed opinions about reality, which you have to work hard to unpack. Judgment and authentic discernment often have a very fine dividing line between them. It's highly beneficial, of course, to be able to form accurate discernments of the nature of reality around you and the behaviorisms of other sentient life. They all affect your path in some way. The soul can then choose the aligned flow through the multidimensional landscape you form. But when a discernment slips into a rigidly fixed opinion about someone, or about the surrounding circumstances, then that becomes a condemnation of reality, which is where discernment becomes judgment. This is not only limiting of those around you, because of the often subconscious projection of judgment, but also self-limiting, because it limits more rapid evolutionary change. Everything is of consciousness. If you strictly believe something to be a particular way, then this hampers the possibility that you can change things to a more highly evolved pattern. In my observation, this is a classic challenge of the Sirius archetype. It is best overcome not by denying the opinions one forms, but working to be as open with them as possible, softening any tightness in the heart chakra where the judgment is often formed, being clear in the mind that all things can and do change. Working with the Christ consciousness can be a great help in softening judgmentalism and realigning it to authentic non-judgmental discernment. It requires a great deal of acceptance of others through fully opening the heart. Work particularly on acceptance. 3. Tightening of the solar plexus. This chakra connects into lower mind and the plane of the intellect. Psychics and mediums often have a very open solar plexus chakra. It's where we start to read the patterning through the field as it's coming into being, and so witness the physical manifestation of synchronicity. It leads to an interpretation of future landing now. An evolution of that is where you become able to amplify and bring the flow into physical manifestation. We are creative beings and meant to express creativity. However, such a gift comes with great responsibility too, realizing that the manifestations you bring into being can, and will, affect the whole. Some may use their parking angels in the 4D to manifest that much-needed parking slot, but what if a less abled person was meant, by the flow, to have it? We are all interconnected. Every action impacts the whole. That said, it is my observation we are also meant to become active co-creators within the consensus reality. That is a facet of the emergent humanity. To deny the flow coming through you is also ego. So it's important to our very well-being to allow active manifestation to amplify through us. The challenge arises where this amplification causes you to fixate around the manifestations you are meant to bring into being. It generates tightness in the head, and contracting down in the solar plexus, experienced as headaches and nausea, classic symptoms of attachment and misaligned action. It ultimately leads to a disconnection from the flow and then creating field constructs according to a separated agenda. This is exactly what the opposing consciousness has done in many constellations. The risk is to fall into that intervention and to become an unwitting part of it. That's exactly the place countless millions find themselves locked into within society. It is anything but civilized. If the influence of excessive control impacts you in the solar plexus, and also the third eye, my observation is you'll have to work hard to realign the distortion, with full commitment, that can take many to properly fulfill. I've witnessed many who've manifested a realigning path that leads to countless failures to create. Their very soul derails manifestation, often right at the last moment. It's a way of softening the solar plexus action, by causing it to engage in creative acts, but most importantly, not attaching to the outcome, not needing it to go a certain way. Thus healing leads to fluid and flexible action, effortlessly expanding and contracting, coming into focus, before dissolving into expansion. In this way, only aligned creations are brought into being. Work particularly on being within the doing. 2. Emotional attachment of the sacral chakra. In an emotional sense, it is my observation that the serious influence is highly loyal in relationships and can be very self-sacrificing. This comes with the caveat that there is often some deeper need due to a sense of community belonging. It means they can be very needy within relationship, with a tendency to manipulate and emotionally blackmail. An inherent karmic disconnect from the divine flow has led to the fear of isolation, which is partially fulfilled by partnership. Often someone with a serious emotional archetype will also tend to project their emotional pain into their outer environment. By spreading the pain, it becomes easier to tolerate, but crucially, the karmic source is not engaged or worked with. There's often an emotional fizz on the surface, but without properly internalizing so as to unravel the roots of the karma. Try this 9-step spiritual healing process for dealing with karmic source pain. Syrians are strongly community-orientated, which at its core is a good thing of course, but it is also often due to this emotional neediness that community connections are sought. Facebook, YouTube and other portal sites, to my mind, are classic manifestations of that. The connections are mostly shallow and on the surface. The emotions spread virally at a surface level so as to pull in and attach. There are of course many good aspects of the internet, the spread of knowledge and the activation of consciousness. The challenge is where people attach and get addicted, emotionally and mentally. Obsessive compulsive behavior and addiction are typical of the serious archetype. The key to dealing with emotional attachment is to express it and bring it out into the open. Yes, this is important, because that way, you're provided signposts in the direction you must work. But the alchemical change can only happen internally. So you must internalize the inquiry and explore deep into the source pain of the problem in order to realign it. That means allowing the experience to be there and working into it so as to soften it, and allow aligned soul to come through, in which case the distortion dissolves. Work particularly on acceptance of solitude. I've shared countless tips, tools and advice for dealing with such distortions in the book 5 Gateways. 1. Excessive consumption and distorted sexuality. These tend to be root chakra distortions, but also sacral. The central theme of the serious karmic challenge is lack of trust due to a general disconnect from the divine. This understandably happens in places of great density. The soul fixates on objects in the outer landscape and so contracts into that reality. Think of the metaphoric apple from the Garden of Eden. The taste is so exquisite, the form so perfected, that when you consume of it, then it's easy to become identified with what you've consumed. The more you engross within that experience, the more disconnected you become. Not that we shouldn't experience and enjoy the apple in all its myriad of forms, of course. That's not to attach to the experience. Non-attachment is not mastered, however, through denial and renunciation. On the contrary, it's by fully engaging and partaking of the activities that would attach you, and working into them with non-self-judgment, but in the midst of them, always attuning to the sense of rightness of the soul. You're working to connect with the expansive feelings of soul all the time. This is essentially what is meant by Tantra, being fully in the experience, but always reconnecting the divine loop of consciousness whilst in it. This is as true for all consumptive expressions, from sex, to physical exercise. what you purchase and what you eat. Check out the Open Hand Forum thread exploring sacred sexuality. In sexual intimacy, I believe it is essential to allow freedom of consenting expression, so as to overcome ego-generating taboo. Dominant and submissive expressions are natural manifestations into our natural rendering to the universal flow, and also harnessing it. To deny these natural feelings, or to attach to them, is to create internal polarity and therefore a disconnect. Aligned, non-attached sexuality is one of the most effective ways to activate and attune full kundalini, for beneficial integration into our natural creativity, in alignment with the divine flow. I've shared some views in this video below, called Healing the Divine Warrior. It's equally applicable to men and women dealing with essences of Syrian karmic distortion. There are similarities and overlaps with rapture consciousness. Although the Syrian archetype is more erudite and sophisticated, the raptor on the other hand is much more raw and basic instinctual. Our cosmic heritage, the time is ripe to gain a much broader understanding of how greater cosmic connections are influencing the human journey. It is not act heritage. What's much more important is to realize what kind of karmic influences your consciousness might be being subjected to. Awareness is always the key to alignment and resolution. It is also essential we step into profound self-honesty. The path of true enlightenment can begin nowhere else. Our distortions might seem unsexy and uncool. At times they will likely come with taboo and stigma. But honoring the distortions we carry is the first step to dealing with them. It's time to own our shit by letting go of self-judgment. No one is without distortion. That is the very nature of the relativistic experience. In any case, at a soul level, we have sacred agreements to take on this density so as to channel realigning light into it. It's only by fully embodying the distortion that you can realign it. So let's look honestly into what's manifesting in our lives. Accept that it might have much wider causality than originally assumed. Then work courageously into it. That way, you'll process karma much more quickly and come back into the welcome embrace of the divine. End of the message. Much love to all of you soul sisters, brothers. Don't forget to subscribe and click the bell to get notified moment by moment. Watch DNA Awakening previous videos for a universal understanding about our existence. New subscribers will be updated with the latest articles and informations. We hope this channel has helped you discover where to start on your actual spiritual path. It's a good karma to put a like, comment, subscribe and share with your beloved ones. Leave your suggestion in the field below. All the love to you, beautiful soul.